In this episode of Youth Work Toolbox, we look at the youth worker as manager, part two, skills, qualities, and abilities.
Welcome to the Youth Work Toolbox podcast, where it's all about equipping one generation to serve the next. Now here's your host.
He's allergic to mushrooms.
Tony Brown.
Hello and welcome to Youth Work Toolbox podcast, episode number 8, with me, Tony Brown. And whether you've been working with young people for 2 decades, 2 years or 2 weeks, we can all improve our practice in one way or another and take youth provision to the next level. And as you know, that's what it's all about here on Youth Work Toolbox. And I trust you'll find something useful, something that you can implement into your practice from listening to these podcasts and the content you'll find on the blog. And if you do, I'd appreciate if you'd send me an email and let me know what you found useful. What I do want to do before I get into the content is to send a shout out to a few listeners and subscribers that have sent me questions, etc. via email. Firstly, I want to send a big shout out to Paul Webster. Now, Paul runs an organisation called Cypher Projects, using street dance to work with young people. And you can check him out at cypherprojects.co.uk. Also, I want to send a shout out to Matt Lent from treetoptraining.co.uk. And Matt set up a communal blog for the youth sector called the Youth Sector Blog. And what I'll do, I'll put links to this blog in the show notes. But basically, it's a communal blog where people can contribute thoughts, ideas, projects, etc., just to help build the youth sector community. So I have to say I've struggled to contribute lately. I mean, for those that have been following the podcast and the blog, you'll know I haven't posted anything new on my own blog for some time. So I have really struggled for time to get any content over there. But what I do plan to do is to do a mini podcast. So it wouldn't be a full Youth Work Toolbox podcast. It would just be a mini podcast, only a short, say 5-10 minutes podcast. And I'll just do a feature and post that on the Youth Sector blog. So that's what I plan to do. So a big shout out to Matt. The content's coming, mate. Please bear with me. And all you guys out there, go and check it out. And if you feel like you could make a valuable contribution, I'm sure Matt would be most grateful for that content. I also wanted to share something. I was challenged recently. I had a subscriber contact me. Now, this is someone who contacted me through Twitter. They found the blog, read a few posts, and they basically wanted to access the podcasts and the free audio gifts that's available on the blog. But basically, she's deaf, and she basically requested if I could provide her with a full transcript of the podcasts and any audio content. And it challenged me. Obviously, my main content method is audio. I just find it easier to provide content in an audio format rather than written. But in terms of equal opportunities and, you know, making content accessible, it got me thinking. So what I endeavor to do is for each audio podcast is to also provide a full written transcript. Now, obviously, I'm going to have to find someone to do this for me or find a way to get this done. But I think it's important. It's easy to get tunnel visioned. You know, when we work with young people in the physical, we're always encouraging and encouraged to take into consideration equal opportunities in terms of accessing provision, making your buildings and your projects accessible to all, and putting what you'd say reasonable adjustments in place to support those who may not be able to access the provision as easily as someone who is able-bodied. So I need to practice what I preach. So I am going to provide this young lady with a full written transcript of the audio she's already downloaded or she's already requested. And like I said, I will endeavour to put a full written transcript of any audio content that's posted in the near future. So guys, hold me to account. I need to get it done. And I think it might even be a gap in the market in terms of, you know, web-based content. Obviously, there's a lot of videos, a lot of audio, but there's a huge cohort of people out there who can't access that because they may be visually impaired or or have hearing impairments. So it's just something we need to take into consideration. So I just wanted to share that. So since the last episode, there's been a lot going on. I mean, believe it or not, I actually recorded part one to this management series back in November. What I did plan to do was to record 3 or 4 episodes back to back because I knew there's going to be time constraints. However, I just didn't get to do that. So there's been a lot gone on since then. If you remember, in episode 5, I interviewed a good friend of mine, Herman Stewart. He's the author of the book, Every Child Needs a Mentor. And Herman's been doing some groundbreaking work trying to take mentoring to every child. And he's invited me to support some of the work he's doing. And, you know, we're looking at developing a mentoring platform that could really be a game changer and change the face of mentoring in the UK. So that's really exciting. So I'll try and keep you updated about some of the developments there. And once things go public, I will point you to all the relevant links and web pages, etc. So that's one project I've been involved in. I've also been doing a bit of business consultancy. I was approached by a local organisation who deliver alternative education provision. And I've just been supporting them to develop a strategic marketing plan and just to get a few foundational things in place just to take their business to the next level. On top of that, I've been helping a few friends develop some websites using WordPress. So again, that's been good. I've had to learn a few new tricks and techniques about developing WordPress sites. And I mean, you may see a few changes on the Youth Work Toolbox blog in the near future. I'm considering changing the theme, so keep your eyes peeled for that. So that's just a few developments. So let's get to the main content of the show. Last episode, we looked at the main functions of a manager. So we looked at what is management. In this episode, what we want to focus on is the skills, qualities, and abilities a good manager should have. Now, when I was putting this show together, I had pages and pages of qualities, skills, and abilities that I could talk about. But what I wanted to do was filter it down to those skills and abilities and qualities that are more specific to management. What I found was a lot of the qualities that I could have spoke about were kind of generic to any employee. If you talk about integrity, for example, I would expect any good employee to have integrity. If you're talking about honesty and being trustworthy, being a good timekeeper, again, I would expect any employee or any person really in business or whatever field to display those qualities and abilities. So what I wanted to do, as I said, was to focus on the skills, qualities, and abilities that are more specific to someone in a leadership or management role. Now, these are not exhaustive. I'm sure you could share others that are quite specific that I may have missed out. If you do want to add something, just share a comment. So I'm just going to share some of the key ones I feel a good manager should have. The first skill I think every good manager should have is leadership ability. They need leadership skills. Now, from the offset, what I would say is not all managers are leaders and not all leaders are managers. Now, some people would ask, what's the difference? And I would say management is about doing things right. Leadership is about doing the right thing. I'd say management is more positional, so it's about the title, where leadership is more influential. But good managers need to be able to lead. They need to be able to lead the team, not just direct them from the top, but to be able to get out there and, you know, set a good example, to model the behavior that they require or that they desire. They should be able to roll the sleeves up and show the team the standards expected. Now, obviously, for a manager, there's not an expectation for them to do the work on a day-to-day basis. But for a good manager, I think it's important that they're able to lead from the front, to set an example, to set a standard. So leadership skills are key. Now, if you want to dig a bit deeper into leadership, I'm sure you all know or you've heard of John Maxwell. He's an author, he's a speaker, and he's basically the leadership guru. So if you want to know more about leadership skills, leadership abilities, just read anything or listen to anything by John Maxwell. He really goes in depth in terms of the function of a leader and leadership skills. Now, to put it into context, imagine you're sitting around a table and you've got a manager who is leading the meeting because they've got the title as manager. And around that table, there's a number of influential individuals who may not hold the leadership title or be, you know, the manager or the CEO or the executive of that organization. However, they're very influential. The workforce respect them, look up to them, listen to them, maybe see them as role models. Those individuals are more likely to successfully lead that group of people than the manager who leads by position. And what I would say is that the manager who has a team like that shouldn't really fight against it. That manager would make a big mistake by trying to stifle those influential individuals in the fear of losing some authority. But the best thing that manager could do is to empower those individuals and encourage them to lead the group, because that's what a manager does or should do, to identify those influential individuals, those with leadership abilities. You know, a good leader encourages other leaders and builds a legacy through other leaders. So that's the first skill and ability I think any manager or any good manager should have, is leadership ability. Following that, every good manager should have knowledge and experience of the service area they're managing. And I think this is key. It all comes down to competence. A manager should be competent within the area of work they're leading or managing. There's nothing worse than being managed by someone who doesn't understand the field you're operating in. And I've had a number of emails from listeners and subscribers and readers saying they've had this experience. You know, they've worked within a multi-agency setting where they're coming from a youth work background and their manager is coming from a totally different field, whether it's an educational field or social work. And there's just been conflict through misunderstanding of role and a manager not understanding the basic principles of the field. So to me, I think it's really important that the manager has a sound knowledge and experience of the field in which they're managing. You need to be able to know what you're talking about. There's nothing worse than going to team manager wanting some help or support and they can't help because they don't know what to do. They don't understand. So a good manager needs to have a track record within that field. Now, please, when I say that, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that management skills aren't transferable. There are management skills that cross-cut every sector, every industry. But if we're just focusing on what makes a good manager or a great manager, it's really important to have that specific knowledge of the field. For me, the best managers are those who have come up through the ranks, those who have done the face-to-face frontline work and maybe have moved on to project coordination. So they might get an opportunity to manage a project within a project and they've demonstrated success within that area. Then they might be given maybe a bigger project to coordinate and some financial responsibility, some staff management responsibility. And again, you know, they've proven themselves there and just worked their way up. So for me, that's key, to see a progression through the levels. Now, unfortunately, we know it doesn't always go like that. You know, there's times where someone's just, for whatever reason, appointed as a manager. They've got no real track record within the field. You know, they might be drafted in from a whole other service area and just given management responsibility. And in my experience, situations like that aren't always productive or don't always produce the results required. But competence is really important for any manager. So next up is communication skills. Now, communication is fundamental in any aspect of life. And to be able to communicate effectively is a skill that we all need in whatever we do. But I think in the realm of management, it's even more needful. The manager needs to be able to clearly convey a message across multiple levels and platforms. And a manager has to be able to display effective communication in a variety of settings and across a variety of mediums. So it's a really key skill. There's nothing more frustrating than having a message conveyed ineffectively. From the team's perspective, there's nothing worse than having a message sent down from the top that's just not clear, and then going off and doing a piece of work and expending time and energy pulling a project together to only find out that that's not what the manager meant or that's not what the desired outcome was, and it's because the message wasn't conveyed clearly. So in terms of communication skills, we're talking about written communication. Now, a manager has to be able to write in a way that is professional, to be able to use correct grammar and punctuation, because there's an expectation for them to communicate across a number of written mediums, emails, letters, reports, briefing papers, documents, action plans, agendas for meetings. The manager is responsible for producing all of these, so they have to be able to demonstrate effective written communication skills. The manager's also got to be able to communicate well verbally. A good manager should know how to speak publicly. They should be confident to be able to stand in front of large groups and convey a message very clearly, communicating ideas, plans, and just being able to address the workforce in a way that's effective. And I would also include in that delivering presentations. There's nothing worse than having someone delivering a presentation that's just loaded with text and bullet points and data, and having that person just basically reading a slide. A good manager should be able to deliver an effective presentation without being dependent on the data that's on the slides. But the slides should support the manager's presentation. So as well as communicating effectively outwardly, the manager also needs to be a good listener. And I think that it's so easy to forget that communication skills is not just about what comes out your mouth. So I'd say the outward communication, it's also about receiving of information. So the good manager needs to be able to listen. So a good manager should not only be able to hear what they're saying, but listen to what they're saying. There was a quote I heard which really stuck with me, and it was, "If you listen to the whispers, you won't have to hear the screams." So what it's saying is, if you listen to the small voices, the little messages that come from the workforce, you can respond and react and be proactive and avoid any major conflicts. There's nothing worse than having a conversation with someone and you just know they're not listening to you. You know that you can see them. They're just waiting for you to finish what you're saying so they can say what they've already decided what they're going to say. So a good manager needs to be a good listener. And it's such a valuable skill. You know, you learn so much from listening to what people are saying. And as we all know, God gave us two ears and one mouth for a reason. And that's to do twice as much listening as we do talking. Another point related to communication is a good manager should be able to give constructive feedback and to communicate that feedback in a way that is productive, and that's both positive and negative feedback. And I think I'd probably do a more specific feature on this in a future podcast. But giving feedback is a key skill for a manager. And also, a manager needs to be able to be specific with their communications. So when delegating work, giving actions to team members, and just giving general instructions, a good manager should be able to do that in a way that's specific. This is what needs to be done, this is what needs to be done by, and this is the expected outcome. And just to make sure that the team understand what needs to happen. And again, that needs to be communicated clearly and effectively. I think one good skill is asking them to convey back to you what's expected of them. So you could be closing a meeting, actions have been delegated, and you just go around the room to say, okay, so John, you're going to do, and get John to feedback what he's going to do. Okay, and Jane, you're focusing on X, Y, and Z, and your tasks are, and get them to relay that back to you. So it's just clear, because it's so easy to misinterpret what's been said. So that's communication skills. Okay, so next on the list is organizational skills. Managers need to be well organized for many different reasons. What I've found is the further to the top of the organization you get, the faster the pace becomes. Workflows just move at such a rapid pace. Once you become a manager, you've just got so many things you need to deal with on a day-to-day basis. Moment by moment, there's phone calls to respond to, emails coming in. You've got back-to-back meetings. You've got just the day-to-day issues arising that you've got to attend to. There's people just want a piece of you. People want a response from you. People want to run things by you, check things with you. There's just, the pace is just rapid. And to be able to manage effectively at that pace, you've got to be well organized. You've got to have systems in place to be able to help you function. I remember when I first started as a youth worker, and I used to see other more experienced workers with their diaries. And I just never had one. I never functioned with a diary. I was young, and I felt that I could just have all the dates in my head. You know, I knew I was working Tuesday evening and Thursday evening. I had to be there for 6 o'clock and make sure I bring my records with me if I'm doing a DJ workshop. And I could just remember all those things. And as I climbed the ladder and moved from part-time youth work to full-time youth work, there was much more responsibility placed upon me. And what I quickly learned, and I probably learned it the hard way, but what I quickly learned was that I couldn't function at that level with the same system that I was using at a lower level. I just couldn't do it. I couldn't, you know, I found I was forgetting things, I was missing things, and it was just a simple diary. I just needed a diary to be able to keep everything, write things down. And, you know, I say all that just to say that as more responsibility is placed upon you, especially management, you need systems in place to help you to function effectively. That could be just having a notepad that you just write things down. You know, you don't have to document every single thing, but just a notepad that you can just write key things down, key actions, things to follow up. You know, every meeting I go to, I take out my notepad. I've got an A4 spiral bound notepad, and every single meeting I go to, regardless of how important it is, how short it is, I'll write the date, I'll write the purpose of the meeting. So if it's just a catch up with a member of staff, or if it's a manager's meeting, whatever it might be, I'll write the date, the title, and I will just use that page to keep any notes. And sometimes, you know, I'll leave a meeting and only have written two or three things, but the purpose is that if needs be, I can refer back to that notebook just to refresh my memory. What do I need to do following that meeting? And there's many different ways you can organize yourself. I mean, what I would say is at the moment, my desk is a mess. And it's just because the pace has been just so rapid with everything going on. My desk has just become a little bit cluttered, a bit messy. And that impacts on my effectiveness. So I know I need to stop, take stock, and just sort out my desk. Get rid of the piles of paper. Get rid of just the clutter, the unnecessary things. I mean, there's nothing worse than wanting to lay your hand on a document and having to rummage through a mass of papers. You know, if someone walks into my office or comes to see me and they're asking me for something and I'm rummaging through bits of paper, it just, number one, it just doesn't look professional at all. Number two, it shows that you either haven't got a system or you have got a system which you're not using. And it wastes time. You know, if someone came to ask me for a certain document or some notes related to something, I should be able to just go straight to a filing system or straight to a folder, pull it out, there you go. So just organizing your projects, your assignments and your documents, whether it be in folders, physical folders, online folders, however, just be organized. So the next one is one that I've challenged a number of times, and it's around time management. And I've challenged people who talk about time management just simply because I believe that you can't manage time. Regardless of how hard you try, you can't stop the clock from ticking. You can't manage time. What I've learned is it's about self-management or task management. It's managing yourself and managing the tasks that you're obliged to complete. So time management is self-management. You've got as much time as everyone else. Everyone's got 24 hours in a day. You might have more tasks than a colleague to complete. You may have more responsibility than others. You may have less responsibility, but you've got the same amount of time and you've got a professional obligation to complete those tasks which you're accountable for within the time you've got. So it's about managing yourself. There's times where you have to just say, sorry, I can't do that. I need to do this. You know, when people come and want to just pop in and say, have you got a minute? Sorry, I'm working on this. Can you come back at 11 o'clock? So it's about managing yourself. It's about being disciplined. And there's so many tools out there and so many different, there's so much information about time management. I don't need to labour this point, but that's just my perspective. But I'm sure we all agree, leaders need to be able to handle tasks and assignments in a timely manner. And if you just look at, if you look at your time, similar to finances, both of them need to be budgeted wisely, or else you'll end up in overdraft. You'll end up in deficit without enough time to complete the tasks that you're accountable for. So budget your time, manage yourself, and manage your tasks, and you'll be an effective manager. So linked to that is discipline. So it's the ability to lay aside the things that you want to do to ensure you do the things that you need to do, the things that need to be done. Discipline is about self-mastery. It's about knowing that there's certain things that will cause you to task avoid. There's certain things that will distract you. I know for me, my phone, email, Twitter, those things, they're such a distraction. And you've got a number of tasks you need to work through, and the emails are just pinging away, or your phone's ringing off, and you've just got to discipline yourself to say, right, I'm turning my phone off, I'm turning off my email client, and I'm working through this task or this job list. And it's clear, a lot of these skills and abilities, they all work together, and they all interlink in one way or another. So you'll find as you develop or implement self-discipline, time management, self-management, and task management will fall into place as you begin to be more focused on what you need to do, what you need to achieve, and then implement the discipline to do those things. You'll find you've got more time to do things, or you get things done quicker. So how can you implement self-discipline? And really, all discipline is routine. It's about every day having a routine and implementing it and sticking with it until it becomes habitual. If you set yourself a routine of every day you get into work, you just take a few minutes just to write down on a things to do list or in your notepad the most important tasks you need to accomplish for that day. And then you allocate some time to work through those tasks and then immediately just start working through them. And you implement that as a habit, you'll find it just becomes routine. And when you start to achieve those tasks, you'll feel much better about work and about yourself. And that good feeling will only encourage you to do it more. Now, obviously, things come up, things happen, and there are things that you're going to have to respond to as a manager. But if it can wait and you can discipline yourself to say, okay, I need to work on this task. So between 9:30 and 10:30, I'm working on this specific task. And you're disciplined enough to not take any phone calls, not respond to it, you know, close your email box. If anyone comes in and taps on your shoulder and says, have you got a minute? Is it urgent? Well, it can wait. Okay, I'll speak to you at X time and give them a time. And just implement that discipline. If you can do that, you'll definitely be a more effective manager and just generally an effective person. So this next attribute or quality, it may seem contradictory to what I just shared in terms of being disciplined, and it's about being flexible and versatile. So like I said, although you want to implement a level of discipline and focus and routine, there are times where things just happen and a manager just has to be flexible to respond to those things and be willing and able to be both non-reactive and not attached to how things have to be done. I think it would be foolish for a manager to be so rigid in his discipline that when an issue arises, he or she is just not willing to respond to it because they're working through a certain task. It's about being responsive to things, but to the right things, not just at every call or every request for your attention or your time that you respond to, but it's being able to make a decision. Okay, this needs my attention and I need to be able to respond to this now. And a manager that's able to make that judgment will be an effective manager. And sometimes there's certain things that you've got to respond to. There's certain things that, regardless of how focused you are in a task or how concrete plans are, when things happen, you've got to change those plans. It could be that you suddenly found out your budget was overspent or your budget's been cut. It could be that there's been an issue at a building where you plan to run some activities or deliver a project and the electricity's gone down or there's been a water leak or something. You've just got to be able to respond speedily to those things. Sometimes it's as simple as, you know, you plan to deliver a certain piece of work or you've committed to doing a certain project and the lead member of staff's phoned in sick. You've got to be able to respond to that. You could have planned to have gone to an important meeting that evening and you've got to just drop that and go and ensure that things are in place to make that project work, or liaise with another colleague to say, okay, can we move this provision from here to there, arrange some transport and get the group over to that venue. So it's just being flexible, being able to think on your feet and make important decisions at the right time. So next up, this next skill or ability is so key when managing people, and it's about conflict resolution. Now in the workplace, conflict occurs just about every day in every environment. And when I say conflict, I'm not talking about employees having fights. I'm just talking about just general disagreements and differences of opinion. And in the workplace, the manager needs to be able to deal with this in a way that doesn't hinder the goals being achieved. When you've got two members of staff who maybe share an office and they just differ, they've got different personalities, they come from different backgrounds, they just live differently, it's inevitable there's going to be conflict. And like I said, in an office environment, it's very easy for those differences to be magnified and for those minor disagreements just to be blown out of proportion. And conflict between employees can cause awkward tensions within the team, which can result in bitterness, and that just has a knock-on effect. You start slacking. They can even start to become critical and destructive of each other's work. And as a team, you know, when you've got things you need to get done, you've got to put those things aside and work together. And oftentimes it's a manager's role to be able to act as a mediator between the workers. You could even have conflict between a worker and a service user. There's times where a service user might make a complaint or have a disagreement with a member of staff. It might be a member of staff you're managing has a conflict with a member of staff they're managing. And again, you've got to be the go-between, the middleman, the mediator between each party. And there's a lot of skills that come into play here. To be able to resolve the conflict effectively, the manager needs to be able to listen to both parties without any bias, to be able to identify issues, suggest ways forward, explore ways forward, discuss potential solutions, agree on solutions, and follow up. So conflict resolution is a very, very important skill that the effective manager should have, and if not, should develop. Off the back of that, and again, like I said, a lot of these skills and abilities, they're all intertwined, is intuition. Intuition is the capacity of knowing without the use of rational processes. And apparently it's the cornerstone of emotional intelligence. Now, we'd probably just say it's a gut feeling. It's that feeling in your belly that you have that something's just not right. And the effective manager learns to recognize that feeling and to trust it. And sometimes you've got to go out on a limb and take a risk and risk being wrong and just saying, well, I've kind of got a feeling that things aren't right here, or, you know, just feeling my gut that I need to check this out a bit further. And what you'll find oftentimes is that your gut is right. That feeling you have in your belly, that intuition, 9 times out of 10 is right. I've had situations where a staff member has been managing a small amount of finance and putting some receipts for expenditure to reclaim it back out of petty cash. And my gut just says, look a bit closer at the receipts. And in doing so, I uncovered that there were some receipts in the bunch that shouldn't have been in there. We'd had a discussion about a choice this member of staff had made to spend some money. And within that discussion, although we disagreed, I made the call that you took it on yourself to do that and we wouldn't be reimbursing it. But then looking through these receipts, I found that receipt slipped into a bunch of other receipts for a different claim months down the line. Now, obviously, this called for disciplinary action to be taken, but it was that initial feeling in the gut, that intuition, that said, just take a look. Okay, so next on the list is self-motivation. Now, an effective manager can't motivate others unless he or she can motivate themselves. Self-motivation is the ability to get yourself going. Being self-motivated is understanding and recognizing the goals and developing your own strategies to achieve them. It's just keeping yourself going, being motivated and motivating those who work with you. It's about being committed and putting your all into your job every day without the close supervision of your boss. And again, this links to other skills and abilities we've discussed in this podcast. Discipline, focus, self-management, and being organized. They're all linked. So to have the ability to motivate yourself is a very key skill for the effective manager. The last few skills and abilities I'm going to move through quite quickly and we're going to wrap this up. So another key skill for an effective manager is decisiveness. And that's the ability to make decisions in confidence and to show others that you're capable of making good decisions. Nobody wants a manager who is wavering with their decisions, who just can't say yes or no. There's nothing worse than having a manager who just can't make a decision. So decisiveness, and on the back of that is confidence. The effective manager is confident in themselves, confident in their knowledge, and confident, as I said, in their decisions. And let's be clear, that's confident, not arrogant. Another one is calmness, just the ability to remain calm under pressure. And I would add to that also resilient. A good manager needs to have a level of resilience when the work pressure's on, when there's lots of external pressures, demands placed on you. You've got to have a level of resilience and being able to remain calm and still deliver what's required of you. And there's many other skills and abilities and qualities we could have discussed and I could have mentioned. The original list was just too long. So like I said, I whittled it down to the key ones that I thought were specific to management. And I want to close with this key skill and ability that every effective manager should be able to demonstrate. And that's a sense of humour. I think every effective manager that I've ever worked with or been managed by is able to just have a bit of fun, for there to be some lightness, that in the face of challenge and adversity, just to be able to demonstrate a sense of humour. And I think sometimes at a senior level, people think that humour or lightness denotes weakness or immaturity. And, you know, because you're operating at a senior level or at manager level, you can't crack a joke or bring a laugh to the meeting. I think you need a balance. Humour complements seriousness. And sometimes, you know, when the pressure's on and when there's some tough decisions to be made, a bit of humour in the mix can just lighten the atmosphere. And I think for the staff members as well, to know that they've got a manager who isn't scared to crack a joke or to have a laugh with them, it just creates a good vibe amongst the team. So I'm going to leave you with that. A stellar manager has got a sense of humour. So that's it for this episode. It's been a bit of a long one, but I think it's been valuable. If you have found it useful, I'd be happy to hear from you. If you're on the blog and you want to leave a comment, then please feel free to do so below. If you're in iTunes, then I'd love for you to leave me a review. Let me know what you thought about the show. And if you want to send me an email, then you can contact me on tony@youthworktoolbox.com. And just tell me what you thought. Tell me what your thoughts are. Have I missed anything? Were there any qualities and abilities you would have wanted to have seen in the list? And if you just want to say hi, then that's fine. You can do that. So until next episode, have a good one. Look after yourself and God bless. Take care.
Thanks for listening to the Youth Work Toolbox podcast at youthworktoolbox.com. Stay tuned for the next episode. Until then, give them the best you've got.